thank you, Makrina, for the wonderful introduction. And I thank you all for having invited me here. I thank you for the good, wonderful spring weather. And I'm really glad to be here. I'm going to start with my conclusion, because I'm not very good at timekeeping. So just in case I don't reach that stage, you at least will have my conclusion. Now, having strived to show how growing up in East Africa entails the number of identity creation channels, we have shown in this presentation, or the presentation that I'm going to give, how film, Facebook, exchanges and music have come to form the modern East African and perhaps African youth's popular e-cultural outlook that strives to define and give identity to such youth. One discovers in these identity creation channels the characteristics of popular culture which call for fresh considerations of popular East African culture and the necessity for a discussion on national vis-a-vis global culture. All this must be done not in a small village that we are told globalization has turned our world into, but I think it's within the context of a small forest where bigger animals can easily identify smaller animals and eat them up. This for me is what globalization is all about. Now, I'm a professor, as she said, of Swahili, specializing in children's literature and Swahili folk tales and contemporary literature at the University of Dar es Salaam. But before that, maybe you should have first things first. I was born. I was born into a very Christian family, a very devout, prayer-ridden family. Moreover, our father, who was a primary school teacher, made sure that we knew how to read and write even before coming of school going age. In fact, before starting my primary school, which is elementary school here, I had already, or even kindergarten, I had already read a good part of the New Testament and abridged versions of books, all translated into Swahili, such as Gulliver's Travels, Pilgrim's Progress, Robinson Crusoe, among many others. These, and especially the Book of Revelation, contributed a very big part of my childhood dreams at night. They enhanced my child's imagination, fear, curiosity, creative mind, while generating a love of books for me from that tender age. My parents, particularly my father, were the most ardent Lutheran believers. We prayed at almost every event, before and after a meal, before and after work, before and after a journey, before and after a feast, before and after clearing the field, before and after planting, before and after weeding, before and after harvesting, and so on. We loved Sundays, though. Because on the Lord's Day, nobody was allowed to do anything resembling work. So the scriptures had instructed. And we were told that except for his short walk, where he discovered Adam hiding in the bushes, the good Lord actually rested, completely rested on the seventh day. And we were told that the seventh day is Sunday. Okay? So, we were also, to our total bliss, told never to work, do anything like work on Sundays. All we did was to eat food that had been prepared the day before, and we sang, we sat around singing, talking, being preached to, and praying again. One was not even allowed to fell a well-ripened bunch of bananas on its tree. Unfortunately, one discovered it like we did, my sister and I, one Sunday afternoon. When my sister and I broke all the rules and were fittingly punished the next day. This experience gave me the first major ingredient of my identity, of Christianity and written books, written stories, most of foreign origins. Now as kids, my elder sister and I used to hate it when the prayers got to be just a little too many, too much. And always our way out was to pretend that our grandmother had instructed that we go and visit her. And so we ran to our grandparents' home, which was not too far away from our place. There we were always a bunch of about 15 grandchildren at any particular time. Well assured of a meal which we found to be more palatable, the meal was actually, it was more delicious than the meal that we were getting at home, every time. And I always wondered why, you know. But also, above all, we eagerly awaited the exciting season of storytelling, stories that were narrated in our mother tongue, Kipare. Stories that had our ears and eyes glued on our grandmother. Our grandfather was a different type. Later on, in fact, we likened him to Okonkwo, if you read the Things Fall Apart. Mm-hmm. But that is another story, and I think I'll narrate the story of my grandfather next time, if you invite me. But today I'll concentrate on my grandmother. So it was there at our grandparents' house by the fireside surrounding our grandmother that we witnessed the greatest storyteller rolling her big eyes as she roared and imitated Simba the lion, the king of the jungles, and a mischievous smile as she mockingly acted the exploits of Sungura, the cunning hare, a renowned trickster who could trick anybody, anytime, anywhere. Or as grandma's quiet and somber face imitated Kobe, the wise tortoise, the only one who had managed to outwit Sungura, the trickster. But grandma also narrated to us stories of people, stories of human beings. And I remember her simulation of a girl called Mbozia, a poor little orphaned girl who had been buried in a secret grave in the forest by the evil stepmother and her daughters. And she had stayed there for many days, to the extent that she was forced to eat her nails for food. And she was miraculously saved later on, as you know these stories of Cinderella, right? Yes, grandma told us stories also of people who traveled to far off lands in search of adventure and precious stones. Together with grandma, we turned into lions, rabbits, other animals, poor orphans, and other characters, as we were often required to narrate the same stories the next day or the following days. This experience gave me an identity that is grounded in the literary perspective of the oral tradition of our people. Was it Aristotle who said that educating the mind without educating the heart is no education at all? Now, through my grandmother, my socialization process was not only metaphorically repeated, but it was enhanced through manipulation of various symbols. The education that I got from my grandmother was both for the mind and the heart. It left a very effective and lasting mark in my life and also on my identity. Now, when I went to primary school, I read more books, since at that time primary schools used to have very good libraries. I was even appointed the school library keeper, which helped me to really devour ferociously, devour the books of different kinds. And then at that time we had the East African Mobile Library Service, where we could borrow books every month, you know, on a monthly basis. So we can see how the reading culture was built into my identity through all these channels, but also the creative culture, the creative mind, the creative aptitude. All these were inbuilt in me through all these aspects of my life, my early life. I really enjoyed my primary school and the mobile library experiences, with the exception of two incidents that still, they really got stuck in my mind. The first one was when I had a row with my mathematics teacher. I argued that actually this multiplication table is nothing other than just an advanced addition, you know. And I told my teacher so, and then he thrashed me. He said, from then on, I hated mathematics all my life. Even now, I mean, when you mention a word like mathematics, I lose. Now, the second one was when a bunch of kids, myself included, secretly ran away from our school one morning to go and look, and if possible, touch the skin and hair of a certain white man, a missionary, I think, who happened to pass by our Lutheran church. Now, having not really satisfied our curiosities, we ran back to school, only to find all the teachers waiting for us with big canes in their hands. We were thoroughly thrashed and told that, with the exception of their skins, their hair and eyes, white people are not different from us. Now, other than those two incidences, which I remember very well, my primary education strengthened my identity and love of books. High school and university did the same, except that here we now met important people like Karl Marx and Engels, Sundiata the Great, Shaka Zulu, Christopher Columbus, Kinjeketile, Charles Dickens, Ernest Hemingway, and others. We read Nyerere, Nkrumah, Marcus Garvey, Malcolm X, and I was lucky to physically meet people like Walter Rodney, who taught us how Europe actually and developed Africa. Now, at that time, we only had the radio to listen to, and we danced to James Brown, Mubarak Mwishehe, and we listened to Miriam Makeba, Hugh Masekela, Lata Mangeshka, Pum Kuthum. A handful of us tried writing. Now, when the time came, I even reconnected with the education from my grandmother. My PhD dissertation was on the journey in Zanzibar folktales. Some of us became the professors that we are today. People with multiple, but generally I would say positive identities. Mm. Now, the above are the accounts of youth identity in the good old days. Let us turn to youth identity today. Now, in order to do that, I have to narrate that I later on fell in love, got married, and got children. These never really knew their grandparents' language. They never had any opportunity to sit around, wait for grandma's delicious food, and listen to grandma's tale telling by the fireside. These and other children of their age missed the grandmother's grounded identity as they went to kindergartens. The elite ones even went to English medium kindergartens, where they sang "London Bridge is Burning," "Twinkle Twinkle Little Star," so on. They then moved on to secondary and high schools, where they were strictly warned to speak English only, or no English, no service. So as I'm sure you've read Franz Fanon, he said that besides being able to use a certain syntax, or possessing a morphology of such and such a language, to speak a language means assuming a culture and bearing the weight of civilization. It is to appropriate such languages, worldview, and culture. And the youth were made to be ashamed of their own languages. They were made to cast aside their language, because they are told that without English you cannot survive. In fact, they were even punished when they spoke their own languages at school. They missed the mutual sustenance between what would have been their mother tongue and their community. Now they were made to appropriate and embrace a world and culture which was totally divorced from the realities of their lives. ultimately, for those lucky ones who were to universities, well, all the way up from high school to the university, they hardly held any hearty discussions of issues pertaining to their real problems and situations, other than just rote learning, mainly to pass their examinations, which were done in English. So the minds got educated, but the hearts were left out. At home, they predominantly watched different soap operas on TV from as far away as the USA, Korea, Mexico, Philippines, you know, arguing and discussing how Alejandro loves the cares of Maria Clara. You know, these coupled with beauty contests and pageants that had Hollywood and multinational corporations manufactured concepts of beauty were closely followed in defining who was beautiful and who was not. I remember, I think it was Toni Morrison who said, the most dangerous concept ever invented by human beings is the concept of beauty. And I think she was right. Aided by the media, mostly Western media, Hollywood and multinationals selling beauty products, cheatingly and dangerously defined to the East African youth what to be beautiful or handsome entailed. The youth embraced the market forces by buying products that would slim their bodies, bleach their dark African skins, fry their pinky hair, and fill their lungs with nicotine tar. Now you could notice that Fanon's black skin white mask syndrome was once again a fully embedded ingredient of the youth identity in East Africa. And of course, it made Lawino start crying afresh. Now I have is it showing? Now this is one example of the beauty contests in Tanzania and Kenya as part of Miss World. So you have these Hollywood standards being followed. But also at the same time, in Tanzania and Kenya and Uganda and Zambia and Burundi and so on, that there was another direction that was being taken to counter Hollywood. So it was the opposite again. You have Miss Bantu. This is one of the participants in Miss Bantu contest. And this one. Now, this conflict of Hollywood and Miss Bantu, I think for me it's a clear indication of the confusion of identity. That these people are wondering, who are we? What kind of people should we be? And invariably, of course, the Hollywood and multinationals, they win because of obvious reasons. We reserve this dimension, this, you know, for other presentations another time. We won't talk too much about it. So for those people who did not make it to the university, they chose different vocations. A number of them joined the informal sector, including film and music, and hardly any chose to go back to the village. Now I'm going to just use three public spaces in which the youth in East Africa have shown their identity making and growth. These are film, Facebook, and music. Now, youth identity questions as embodied in film in East Africa are so telling. Let us use the example of the film industry in Tanzania, popularly referred to as Tollywood. You know, you have so many woods now. Tollywood, Bollywood. Kellywood, that's Kenyan. So Tollywood is currently a very big supply of films whose repeated themes and motifs vary from broken hearts, jealousies in love affairs, family conflicts, some limited political innuendos, magic, and then the most current thing in Tollywood films is the evangelical cure for all, you know, due ex machina. It's like if you have any problems, you can go to church, and that, you know, your problems will be miraculously solved. Like in all these, the ones that deal with love affairs appear most on television in Tanzania, Kenya, Uganda, and they're the ones whose actors, and especially actresses, don the front pages of popular fast-selling magazines, like the ones we are witnessing in my slides. One particular feature of these films is its portrayal of the female body that is inscribed through and through. This seems to be the main identity that is given to especially female characters, and we are going to use it as a sample of how youth identity is built through film in East Africa. Now, when I talked to some tabloid owners who did not want their names to be mentioned, they proudly answered that in doing so, in doing what they do, at least, you know, in showing these girls, they're able to teach the rest of society not to behave that way. But also, as an aside, they say that they were also able to sell tens of thousands of copies of such tabloids. Therefore, in effect, the bodies of Tollywood actresses are doubly inscribed and doubly sold, both in the tabloids and in the films in which they act. In Tollywood, as on Friends Wars in Facebook, as we shall see later, the metaphor of the inscription of the female body, and thus the accruing constitution and description of the ideal female body and identity, are imprinted and emphasized. Now, I'm talking about the concept of the description of the female body. If you get this paper, you may follow who has done what in, you know, to produce this concept. I don't think I have the time right now here, but it originates from some French feminist literary theorists, and then it spread all over. We'll talk about that some other time. Now, the inscription that we are talking about here, again, is engineered by the market forces and cash economy that determine gender relations in a commoditized world. Such state of affairs has made the constitution of the body of woman in the media so plastic that it can be molded the way the director of the film, the writer, the Facebook friends, male friends, deem it fit, turning such a body into a text written upon it and from which it is not distinguishable as a social being, but just a pleasure-satiating doll. Indeed, popular inscription of the female body in the media in general and in Tollywood films and friendly exchanges and comments on Facebook walls in particular impose literal, figurative, interpretive outlook that sells the films as it amplifies female body inscription while condemning such a body to lust and ridicule. I wish I could give you a description of some sample films, but in the interest of time, I think I will skip this. Get rid of it on your own. But predictably, most it is the temptress in the main female character of most films that caused tears and disaster in families. Okay, I'll talk about Family Disaster for two minutes. The Family Disaster is a film where your two orphaned teenage girls who live with their uncle, and somehow they go on a love-making rampage, changing lovers from fellow students, their teachers, businessmen, etc., for no apparent reason other than money and mostly mere lust. It suffices here to say that in order for their adventures to bear fruits, most actresses have to adorn tiny miniskirts and cleavage-enhancing gadgets that will attract the inscription of their young bodies by lustful men who are enticed into careless and callous love affairs. These are ones that, you know, you get these in film covers, video covers in Tanzania. And this is a popular actress who is actually right now involved in a murder case for Kalaba, another film actor. She's not a very famous one. Again, this is on a film cover, but also it's very popular in tabloids. A picture like this one. Now, in these sample Hollywood films, the directors have made sure that most of the scenes in which the female characters appear, such characters are half, almost fully naked, while their male counterparts or partners are almost always fully dressed, even in love-making scenes. Now, this is a very short account of Tanzania films, Hollywood films, and as I'll talk later on, I'm trying to be very unfair to the youth, and I have my own intentions, but we'll talk about those intentions later. Definitely there are some other better films within Hollywood. Now, let's look at the Facebook. And I'm going to look at Facebook female body inscription as youth identity on Facebook walls also. Now, my entry into Facebook was kind of accidental. I told my kids, you know, that you see, now we can do contacts on Facebook. And they say, Dad, what are you doing on Facebook? Now that set me thinking. I said, okay, there must be something in Facebook, yeah, which I'm not supposed to know. it caught my interest. But I also think that this part of my lecture is very timely because today Peter celebrates its seventh year.
That's right.
And I read it on USA Today yesterday. There is a age-old bad judgment lives long in digital age. Then the next page says, good, bad, or ugly, you are forced to tweet. This is interesting, because it's a very interesting article. Because it's concerns, actually, are my concerns here. But it's even worse, because Twitter has been used for murder, I don't know, through Twitter. And this shows how serious actually these social platforms are, and they can be quite negative. Now, as we all know, Facebook has become one of the most common and popular public spaces and social forums. It is especially fashionable with the youth, so much so that, as we'll explain later, it has turned into youth's popular e-culture. It is in Facebook that members will make friends, you know about this, from all over the world, sometimes exchanging very serious socio-economic and political views and commentaries, but most of the time, actually, just socializing and exchanging greetings and even petty news, comments, and appreciative remarks. Now, I joined Facebook for about 3 or so months and continuously followed and some of the times remotely participated in the discussions and commentaries, especially those aimed at female pictures and photos generously supplied by the Facebook female members themselves. I'm not sure about the situation here. For obvious reasons, my samples, the data that I took from Facebook, I've not mentioned names. And where I've shown pictures, I've made sure that I got the faces, but you know, we don't identify them in case they're your friends. And then I looked at the actual commentaries, pictures posted by female members of Facebook, incidentally, hardly any time do you see male Facebookers, if you can call them, posting their pictures. And this, you know. But the rough translation that I give to these comments, maybe sometimes they're not all that perfect, because youth language can be very tricky. And since some of it is slang. But I will just read you a few comments given to pictures that were posted. Like this one, commentator says, "I like the one with your tongue sticking out. Baby, I like your eyes and lips. Cute body. You can't ask for more buttocks. The nice behind is there. You seem to know the value of your behind. All pictures focus on one side, showing the nice behind. Others do create buttocks that are both artificially enhanced by use of Chinese medicine, but mine is now, this is a face wall owner. But mine is original. Why should I not be proud of it?" Then nice booty. "In truth, if God is the creator, he overspent his time on you. And he must have woken up very early on that day that he created you. Big up, my dear, beautiful and classy like an ash of tree. This is it, cute buttocks like those of Nicki Minaj." And so on and so forth. I've been on this one. Now, as you can see from this sample of e-walls, just like in the Tollywood movies, woman is represented through commentaries whose patriarchal language focuses and defines her principally through her body or even body parts. Now, we all know that language is how we perceive and define the world around us. However, that perception and definition may lead us to see the world as a fixed entity, in which case then our language may be, in this instance, may treat the female body as fixed. However, since language is unstable and not fixed, so are the results of the perceptions and definitions accruing from it. Now, the perceptions that one gets from the sampled Facebook walls regarding female bodies seem to be fixed insofar as they are given by male commentators. The masculine text then gives us the interpretation and perception of female body through inscription of the same body. Body parts such as lips, eyes, buttocks, the face, and so on are repeatedly used in the inscription so much so that ultimately the fixed image that one gets of such a body is reduced to some parts considered to constitute a sexy outlook. In other words, the female body dismembered. You see it in terms of body parts. Even when the commentaries are use metaphors such as the one mentioned of the ash of tree and so on, others that compare the body to different flowers, the rose is particularly popular, fruits, mostly the apple, and birds such as the peacock, they do not go beyond the body since they ultimately bring our focus onto the body that is supposedly a tall and slim line. The referred trees smells as nice as the rose, you know, tastes as sweet as the apple, and generally looks as beautiful as a peacock. Even where one would have expected to see authentic representation of female body by Facebook female members, one gets disappointed by such members whose readiness to generously supply the Facebook members with such provocative pictures and whose reactions to the inscription done by their male friends is strangely thinking. Accept, you know, they accept the inscription. So our conclusion regarding the instances that are cited from Tollywood and Facebook walls then is that a woman is reduced to things rather than a wholesome being. We are made to see, not to see her as a person, but rather as either a combination of body parts that attract the lusts of men, or as things outside her that connote beauty in the eyes of men. My question is this the ideal identity for the female youth in East Africa? Now, I realize that I've been quite negative in the portrayal of the identity of youth in East Africa. But this has been intentional, although in the words of Chimamanda Adichie, it may seem like I've entered the danger zone of a single story. Now, quote, in a similar situation, Fanon gives the following justification. He says, in his black skin, white masks, it is not because my patient's liver is functioning normally that his kidneys are healthy. Since his liver is found to be working normally, it's only normal for me to leave it at that and turn my attention to the kidneys. So what I've done was to turn my attention to the sick kidneys of the youth identity in East Africa. And now maybe I should turn to the liver of the music. Although here too we may discover a few sick cells. Let's look at music. I wonder how much time I have. Now the kind of music that was immediately found not only to be Spain but also to be youthful and international was obviously hip-hop. The choice of this particular genre is not only an arbitrary one, not only is it easily transmitted as entertainment through media organs, but also through actual performance when and if one gets lucky to be given the space. And since one of the characteristic features of the so-called globalized world is the dominance of the media, it becomes very important to discuss cultural product or production vis-a-vis the media. Now, other than give details of this genre and its effects on the identity of the youth, which you can find in my paper, I will touch on just four major issues, and this will be my concluding part. First, I'll give a very short historical account of hip-hop music in East Africa. And then second, I'll look at music as youth revolutionary zeal and collaboration in the face of globalization. Then I'll look at music as popular culture that relates to issues of power. Finally, I'll look at music, the way music necessitates a discussion on national culture and national pride. First, a very short historical account of rap or hip hop in East Africa. One of the positive dimensions of hip hop and rap music in East Africa is that historically there has been a connection, an innovative interchange between African cultural forms in general and those from outside Africa that mediated between typical African beats and, for example, Latin American beats. Hip-hop is a product of the artistic link between Africans on the continent and those on the diaspora. It has a very interesting history, which seems to be hinged on the increasing dominance of the powerful media and communication companies in the West. Gradually, though, it emerged as a popular form of an alternative means of communication to resist arbitrariness and oppression. Although later on we discover that there were some reaction moments, such as in the gangsta rap genre that appeared. So the music borrowed its forms from what were considered to be black aesthetics and African oral and musical forms. So East African youth picked up this genre in mid-80s to express their aspirations, desires, frustrations, and thoughts. By the early 1990s, this music had become part of the forms of cultural resistance of the youth. It was at this time that, in spite of what had been happening earlier on, where most media organs had tried to sideline this kind of music, in mid-90s, FM radios, radio stations began to air the music. This was when public debate ensued, whereby most of the defenders of the old ways charged that those that the youth were a confused lot and that they were merely copycats of the Western music. However, forms of expression grew into a major social, political, and economic commentary tool. The music also demonstrated its affinity to traditional forms by examples. Now, the current fever of hip hop music that is gripping East Africa results from social upheavals whereby society is necessarily reproducing itself under the repressive era of globalization that in turn takes from the foreign while casting aside excitement in the same foreign. The ideology that emerges or emanates from the rap music must be viewed as part of a popular culture which must itself be seen in terms of the material life process. Yet, we must guard against viewing culture as a product of a specific interest group to which its phenomena are assigned. It is important, I think, to translate the general social process and tendencies expressed in such circumstances through which our criticism turns into an examination of the whole rather than just part of the whole. On another plane, the flourishing of rap music, hip-hop music in East Africa may as well be a manifestation of the language of commodities, if one may borrow Karl Marx's terminology. Here is where articles of utility, even mental aesthetic utility, turn into commodities as they become products of the labor of private investment over and above the common labor of society. I think even the bodies which we like this body, or even the ones in the Miss, Miss Tanzania, Miss Kenya, Miss Uganda, Miss Rwanda, Miss Burundi contest. The bodies are turned into commodities. They're for sale. And the buyers are watching. And we select one of them, one of those misses. We send her to the world contest and so on. You know, it's that same game that is happening, not only in music, but also in all other aspects of life that can be turned into commodities. Secondly, we look at youth revolutionary and collaboration zeal in the face of globalization. I remember stating elsewhere in another paper that cultural industries that include artistic products are by enlarged products or categories of history that reflect a given people's sense and sensibility at a given time in their social evolution. Now, the new development that is spreading like wildfire in the realm of Israeli oral literature in the form of rap and hip hop music that is played a lot in East African radio stations and beyond is, for me, the new revolutionary zeal among the youth that are very critical of the political, social, and economic policies and conditions in their countries, especially in the face of the so-called globalization. So since most of the music deals with sensitive issues like a corrupt politician, you know, hip-hop music is inevitably satirical. So you have so many satirical numbers. For example, there's this one by Jay Haole, not popularly known as Professor Jay. He has composed two songs. The first one is called Ndio Mzee, literally it means yes sir. And the second one is called Sio Mzee, or no, not so sir. The first one portrays a guy who's contesting for membership, to be a member of parliament. And he promises so many things to the constituents. He even promises that he will buy Mercedes-Benz for barmaids in his constituency. And the people keep on saying, yes sir, yes sir, yes sir. After 5 years, he comes back, he's done nothing. He tries to give some other promises, and now people are saying, no sir, no sir, no sir. Now this kind of music was played during election time, and it had a big effect. And people were told to say no sir to all the promises that were made. People were alert about this situation. And this was in the fashion of Fela Kuti, Fela Kuti, the musician. So the Ndio Mzee and Sio Mzee was not only in Tanzania, but you get so many examples even from Kenya and Uganda. Where, for example, you have a number called the Nchi ya Kitu Kidogo. This is a country of a small thing. You have to offer something in order to be saved, you know, to be saved. So the cultural status of hip hop and rap music is clearly shown today in the media and in public performances. Through it, power relations are produced. The rap numbers are sung mostly in Kiswahili, which is the language understood by the majority of the people, and also in slang that is better understood by the youth. Now, in asserting these power relations, the questions of reception are important for rap music. I'm looking at time here. The questions of reception are important for rap music, and because it can easily be assimilated by the youth than other art forms. It is easy for the youth to make sense of what they hear in rap music or hip hop. Today, the majority of the youth find they are jobless and they are relegated to messenger jobs in the face of globalization that hence all the major means of production to foreigners in the name of what Tanzania has termed ubinafsishaji, which literally translates as individualization, and they like this term better than its translation of privatization. I think it's individualization through and through. So the best way for the youth to vent their frustration with that such a situation seems to be in music, hip-hop, rap music, that is. Paradoxically, it's also through this music that we get some musicians accepting their being African. There's a song called Me Masai Bwana. I'm Masai, I'm truly Masai, and I'm proud of it. Maybe we'll have the chance to watch it. The identity issue goes further, so that through rap music, the youth insist that they are at least symbolically distinct in their outlook and needs. Yet again, once in a while, a message is put across that while people can be socially different, they are at the same time, they can at the same time share the same character. This then is the interrelation between culture and identity that can indeed make a very interesting study. The youth in East Africa, through their upbeat, have decided to speak their minds out in no uncertain terms, although they have also decided to use the satirical voice that I talked about. So you have a list of artists. I won't mention them. In Kenya, for example, you have Ndigidi Maji Maji. They took the public by storm before and after elections with Uwogabe. You just cannot scare them. Song which tops it topped the charts. And then you have Mercy, Myra, Susan, Ibokosia, Henry, Tuku, and others from Kenya. These youths are saying that they belong to and are a part of and parcel of the national cake. They should share that cake. And then you have a group like Old Divide Gorge, which played a number prior to the 2000 year general election in Tanzania. It's charged that those who had been elected to the parliament before had let the people down and so on. And you have Nchia Kidogo by E.W. Eric Wainaina, and so on. In fact, Nchia Kidogo was subsequently used by the opposition alliance, more or less like its signature tune in Kenya. And it helped drive the point home to the electorate regarding the corruption. I think all these symbolize the very interesting and complex cultural mix that calls for a fresh approach as we think and redefine East African cultures, identities, and the different brands of nationalism, which is our next part of the talk. I don't know how to do that. Okay. Now we have collaborative efforts. And you have musicians going multinational. The question of identity raises a more fundamental one of nationalism, national culture, and national pride in the 21st century East Africa. Before we discuss this as our conclusion in this presentation, let us revisit an African icon for guidance and wisdom. As early as 1962, Julius Nyerere, our first president, Mwalimu Nyerere, had stated the following: "I believe that culture is the essence and spirit of any nation. A country that likes its own culture is no more than a collection of people without the spirit that makes them a nation. Of all the crimes of colonialism, there is none worse than the attempt to make us believe we have no indigenous culture of our own, or that what we did was worthless, something we should be ashamed instead of a source of pride. When we were at school, we were told to sing the songs of the Europeans. How many of us were told the songs of Wanyamwezi or Wahehe? Many of us learned to dance to the rumba, the cha-cha-cha, rock and roll, and twist, and even to dance to the waltz and foxtrot. I will skip this one. You're very fair. Now, there are very pertinent questions about the disjunctive representation of the social question in this double time of the nation versus the international. And I think we need to discuss that further. But the issues that scholars of his time raised, and the scholars after his time, Nyerere's time, in the face of and in reality of the so-called globalization, may as well not be used contrary to Mwalimu Nyerere. Now, this new reality necessitates the rapper from East Africa to compose and produce that which will sell. But again, it necessitates one to go beyond the nation, to collaborate with other musicians from other nations. And I'm going to play at least one song. This is a Facebook entry. Another Facebook entry. Now the collaborative efforts in East Africa and Central African youth musicians, the collaboration is an indication of going beyond the nation, going beyond the national capitals. This music has involved collaborations amongst East and Central African musicians, and the identity of the youth has gone beyond Swahili land, beyond just one piece of land to a big chunk of land. For example, there is this collaboration between Q-Chief from Tanzania and Princess Mbanungi from Uganda. The movement is not the best here. Something wrong with it. Aspects of popular culture, rap and hip hop music included. We have insisted that the revolutionary moment of popular culture must necessarily be looked at vis-a-vis the reactionary moment of popular culture. What we have not done, if you think would have been quite interesting and informative, is to compare some aspects of contemporary popular culture with the dominant novel forms of the 60s and 70s that seem to have similar color and intent.